As we begin here with the call to worship for this morning from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand and join us for worship this morning.
At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name,
chapter 52, verse 5 says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Amen.
There's a mountain here before.
Me when I
Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17 says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing."
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love.
Silence and prepare our hearts for the confession of sin. Let us confess our sin. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning because of our old nature. There is a part of us that only wants to make us turn away from you and do that which is evil. At times, Father, we have given in to this old nature and have sinned and fallen short of your glory. We confess this to you so that you may forgive us and cleanse us from that unrighteousness and make us your children again. Wash us and make us clean in your sight, in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. A declaration of grace is from Romans chapter 8, verse 11. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Amen. Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. The Old Testament reading this morning is from Genesis 22, 1 through 18. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here am I." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father, "Abraham, my father." And he said, "Here am I, my son." He said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here am I." He said, "Do not lay a hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of the place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." Our psalm this morning is Psalm 25, 1 through 10. Please respond in the bold print. "To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Amen. Mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. The epistle this morning is James 1, 12 through 18. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Here ends the readings for this day.
The gospel for today is from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for your word. As we hear your word proclaimed today, may it fall on our hearts and our open minds, and may we receive it in such a way that we can also know to share it with the world around us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated, and I'd like to invite the children to come up to the front pew up here.
You guys can come on up. Don't be shy. I brought with me one of my favorite toys. You guys like that? Look at that thing. Isn't that cool? You guys see that? I'm Norwegian. I have some Norwegian blood running through my veins, right? And so here I've got, this is a little Viking. He's got his axe and his sword and a helmet with horns on it. And he's got his nice little boat. And the boat has wheels and oars. It just looks ridiculous, doesn't it? I mean, have you ever seen something like that, and the oars go when the wheels go? And this, I think of, this is a toy, right? Would you guys call this a toy? And maybe an adult might look at that and say it's like a knick-knack. It's something that you're just going to put on a shelf and look at. And I have a question. When does this become an idol? Because you know in the Bible, God says that we shouldn't have any idols. This as a toy, if I were to spend time playing with it, is fine. But you know what happens if I were to say, you know what, it's Sunday morning and I don't feel like going to church because I want to play with my toy instead. That all of a sudden then the toy becomes an idol because I'm worshiping the toy instead of worshiping God. Or what if I put this on the dashboard of my car and I had it facing forward and I named this guy, let's say I named him Thor, and I said, Thor is going to keep me safe everywhere I go because he can see where I'm going and he's protecting me. If I said something like that, then all of a sudden this becomes an idol because I'm putting my trust in this instead of God to watch over me. And so it's very interesting how we can have all kinds of things that are fun to play with and enjoy, but how easy it is for the world around us and for ourselves to turn those things into idols and worship them, and we shouldn't do that. One thing that we really have to watch out for that I find, you guys know what? You probably don't. It's probably a different world. Precious moments. This might be more for the adults. There's these little porcelain figurines are called precious moments dolls, and they look good on the shelf, right? And people display them, but then sometimes they get ones that are angels, and they look to that little piece of porcelain and say, well, that angel is watching over me and keeping me safe here in my home. And all of a sudden, that becomes idolatry instead of a pretty little figurine to look at. So there's all kinds of ways that we can let the world turn things into idols, or we ourselves can turn things into idols that weren't meant to be idols. But I just like playing with this thing because it reminds me of my Norwegian ancestors and how maybe one of them might have been a Viking someday. I doubt it because they were fishermen and farmers. But anyway, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for watching over us and help us to stay away from idols. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, you guys can have a seat. Thank you so much for coming up and listening. Okay. We finished the five solas of the Reformation. And that began with early last year in Advent. I typed into a Word document. I said, "What is a Lutheran?" The idea was this was a sermon series. And then as Lent is beginning here perfectly, I didn't time this, but Lent is beginning perfectly after that five solas of the Reformation ended. I was going through some histories and reminded how it was a big thing in the early days of our country for Lutherans especially. During the season of Lent, to go through the catechism and to reaffirm everybody's faith that they had been catechized, you know, as teenagers, but then as adults to be reminded of that. And so I said, well, let's break down how many Sundays there are, and there's five parts in the catechism. And so I said, I'm going to do one part each Sunday. And then I remembered, as like, it's not been too long since I preached on the Ten Commandments in this church. Let me go look and see how long ago it was. And I did that in 2016, my first year here. So it's been long enough that I can preach on the Ten Commandments again. And the other thing is, I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to say it. But some of you are going to gloss over when I say this. Last time I did this, I did it in 7 sermons. Okay, 10 commandments and 7 sermons. I combined a couple towards the end. This time you're getting all 10 in one go. Why do I worry about time? I don't know. Okay. So the introduction to the 10 commandments is always to remind people that the first 3 commandments are about our relationship with God. It's vertical. We say, right? Up and down. Our relationship with God. And the last 7 commandments are horizontal. Our relationship with our neighbor. How we treat each other as Christians. Different church bodies sometimes number the commandments differently. The Jews numbered them a little bit different than the Catholics and Lutherans number them, and everybody else seems to number them a little bit different than the Jews did or the Catholics and Lutherans did. So there's 3 main categories of how to number them. That's all I'm going to say, other than if I get to Commandment 5 and it doesn't line up with what you memorize as a child as Commandment 5, just know that in the text of the Bible, God did not say commandment number one. And the verse numbers were added later, and how we've numbered them has been a little bit fluid. The numbers don't matter so much other than to give us reference for how these things work. Before I get to commandment one, I want to ask this question, and I want you to think of this question throughout all the commandments. Did God send his son to die on the cross so that he could mandate 10 rules that you must follow in order to get into heaven? The answer is no, right? But when the law is preached, sometimes people hear the law and say, that's going to keep me out of heaven. That's not how the commandments work, okay? The commandments, or if we talk about biblical law, there are two purposes behind it. And the first purpose is to get you to realize that you're not good enough, that you fall short, that you fail, and that you deserve to go to hell, okay? And that's the very first primary intent of the Ten Commandments, to get you to know that you can't do it on your own. And then the second purpose is to teach you a way of life to live as a Christian who knows that you can't do it on your own, but you know Christ did it for you, okay? And so all of a sudden, instead of the Ten Commandments being this big bony finger of the law pointing at you and telling you you're a failure in all of these respects, it becomes your life will be full of joy if you can learn how to live according to this, okay? So there's a drastic change in the commandments from one side of the cross to the other as you become a believer. Sometimes on this side of the cross, we still need that big bony finger, don't we? Sometimes we need the reminder. Okay, commandment number one. You shall have no other gods before me. What does this mean, Luther says in his small catechism? We should fear, love, and trust in God above all things. That has to be the favorite among every single one of the kids I've ever made memorize from the catechism because it is the shortest. We should fear, love, and trust God above all things. They get that one, and then the next week they come and they have to do longer, and oh no, and then it only gets worse and worse and worse as far as memory is concerned. That commandment is, as we teach it, you shall have no other gods before me. It's much longer if you're to read the text. Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 7. God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness or anything that in heaven above or that on the earth beneath, or what that is in the water underneath the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. And even there in the Old Testament, in Exodus, you see both sides of the commandment. God hates sin. God shows love to those who understand the commandment and follow it. Another word that is in there that I always bring up when I read this is that God is a jealous God, because our culture and our community has turned jealousy into this evil thing that destroys relationships. And I always point out that I think jealousy is a great thing. It's an emotion that God has given us. And if I were to describe that, like if some guy walked into the sanctuary here and went over to my wife and started hitting on her, I would get jealous. That's not right, right? And it's that same idea that God wants your love for him, and he doesn't want you sending your love off to somebody else, right? To some other God. If everyone... This is a big, you know, all of the commandments hinge around this, okay? And I could make points throughout all of them, but I'm just going to say that, and I'll bring it up with a couple of them. But if everyone were able to keep this law perfectly, you know what would happen? there would be no more anxiety in our lives. There would be no more worry in our lives, because we would truly, truly know what it meant to trust in God for all things. Luther said of this, specifically of idols, he said, not just making an idol and praying to it, but idolatry occurs in the heart, which pursues other things. And that's the beginning of what I learned this go-around in my study, that every nation, every country, every government that has ever passed laws, they're all about deeds. They're all about things that you do. God's laws here in the Ten Commandments and in the Bible and throughout Old Testament and New Testament are different in the respect that God puts the law on your thoughts and the wills of your heart. So where I'm quite glad in this country, I can't be prosecuted for wanting to kill somebody who I'm angry with, right? They got to wait until I do it. Am I wrong in that? I think I'm right in that. But God looks at that desire of hatred and evil, and he says, you're guilty. And so on that level, we must understand that we are all guilty of all of these Ten Commandments. Romans chapter 1, verse 25 says, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Worshipping the creature or something you have created or something someone else has created rather than the Creator. Pontopitan. Who, raise your hand if you've ever heard the name Pontopitan before. Yeah, I figured as much. In Luther's Small Catechism, Luther's Small Catechism is only like 6 or 7 pages long. It's a very short document. But many of you, if you went through catechism, you had a bigger, thicker book with a lot of pages. And Luther's Small Catechism is basically the point, and then what does this mean in a little paragraph about it. And then Pontopitan goes on for pages and pages and pages, and it's called the explanation to Luther's Small Catechism. And those pages are what is contained, mostly Pontopitan. It's been revised over the years, and people have added to it. But Pontopitan asks some questions. Whom do all idolaters really serve? And his answer, they serve the devil, who is the father of lies and the lord of all impenitent and hardened sinners. 1 John 3:8, the one who practices sin is of the devil. Bony finger of the lie. You hear that? You feel that? And he says, upon what does God then really look? Upon the attitude of our hearts towards him. 1 Samuel 16:7, for God sees not as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. God looks at the heart. Pontopitan continues, I got one more from him. When do we trust God above all things? He says, we trust in God above all things when we have confidence in him as a loving father and when we look to him for every blessing and put all of our affairs into his hands. 1 Peter 5:7, I love this verse, especially on this one. Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Other versions say, cast your burdens unto him because he cares for you. Okay. Where did I go? Oh, I missed. Okay. Number two. We're moving right along, aren't we? Strapping. These will go, they start to go faster as they get through. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold himself guiltless that takes his name in vain. What does this mean, Luther says? We should fear and love God so we do not curse, swear, conjure, lie, or deceive by his name, but call upon him in every time of need and worship him with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. Every once in a while, I look up all these other translations of Bible verses, and I like this very wooden old translation. It's called Young's Literal Translation, and Young would be dead by now, so he's not young anymore, right? The old guy. Thou dost not take up the name of Jehovah thy God for a vain thing. For Jehovah acquitteth not him who taketh up his name for a vain thing, right? And acquitted means to be declared not guilty. So if you take up the Lord's name in vain, you are guilty. Vain is described or defined as overly proud of oneself, especially when concerning appearance, having very little substance, affecting no purpose, being pointless, futile, empty. I also think not just of vanity of using the name of Christ, but also the reminder from Luther that this isn't just talking about using the Lord's name in vain. This is talking about all of our language, when you curse, swear, conjure, lie, or deceive in any way, right? And then I'm always reminded for this commandment to remind people that saying Jiminy Cricket is using the Lord's name in vain, you know, unless you're talking about the cartoon. If you're using Jiminy Cricket as a swear word, or, you know, cheese and crackers, I've heard them all. I've heard so many. The OMGs of the text world, they all fit. But Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10 says, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name Jesus, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. The name is too special. It has too much meaning to use flippantly. Again, there's two ways of looking at every commandment. There's the before the cross and the after the cross. Remember as you hear this commandment that you bear the name of Christ to the world when you live your life in front of the world. Let the world see you as a Christian. Number three, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so we do not despise his word and the preaching of the same, but regard it as holy and gladly hear and learn it. I don't know how much of me wanted to stay home this morning and play with this thing, other than it was sitting here on the pulpit, so I would have had to come to church to get it. And in a lot of ways, I'm joking around with this, but we can all insert whatever it is that we would rather be doing. And God knows, you know, God knows better than you do what you are putting in his place. Our cell phones can get in the way so easily. Our TV shows can get in the way so easily. Our desire to do nothing and just be idle can get in the way so easily. But anything that we do that comes before God is breaking this Sabbath. On the flip side of that, God wants you to know him. And this Sabbath day is also about rest. He wants to give you that rest. I have a hard time talking about the Sabbath day and not mentioning the farmers in Schwer, Illinois, where my last church was, who, after church one Sunday morning, as the neighbor, Steve Rapp, was plowing his field because it had been raining for weeks and they couldn't get out to plow, and he finally had a day he could get out to plow. It was Sunday, and one of the guys from my church, as he left, drove the opposite way of his home to go down and wait for Steve to bring his tractor down to the end of the row. He got out of his car and walked over to the tractor, climbed up into the cab and said, "Don't you know what day of the week it is?" As if to remind him that God desires for him to have rest. I found that interesting. The farmers in Illinois, they believed that their land was blessed because they didn't work on Sunday, and they weren't about to skip that, and they were also more than willing to let the people that didn't go to our church know about it. So it was very legalistic in that sense. Sometimes I wish, because even the Pharisees, you know how I give the Pharisees a bad rap about all their rules? Even the Pharisees and all their rules made exceptions for farmers to be able to get their crops in. You know, there was a relaxed loophole in the law for farmers, not in Schwer. So how do you break the Sabbath? By not putting God first. And you know what this is? This goes back to the first commandment. It's idolatry. It's football, fishing. You know, it's easy for me to come up with the guy things. What about quilt hops? How many ladies in this church have missed church to go on a quilt hop? Dare you to raise your hand? No, I don't raise your hand. Luke chapter 14, verse 5 says, then he asked them, if one of you has a son or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out? See the exceptions that even Christ gives? Mark chapter 2, verses 27 and 28. Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." God knows you need rest, and he wants to give you rest. He also knows that you need, because he created you, you need to worship him, and he wants to give you time to do that. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Do you hear the grace in the midst of the law when you hear this commandment? Okay, I mentioned earlier I break the commandments at commandment 3. This is a vertical, and commandment 4 through 10 is horizontal. And in my study this time around, I found a couple different people, which I don't know if I've noticed this before. If I had, it didn't stick. But commandment 4 is a transitional commandment in a lot of ways. "Honor thy father and mother, that the days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." Honoring your father and mother, and as Luther is very clear to describe this, he says this isn't just your parents, your genetic parents here on earth, but this is anyone who is in authority over you, and ultimately this is your heavenly Father. And so if this commandment applies to your relationship with God as Father in heaven, then this transitions from the first three being your vertical down to our horizontal relationship. Luther says, "What does this mean? We should fear and love God so we do not despise our parents and superiors, nor provoke them to anger, but honor, serve, obey, love, and respect them." So many times when I would read this commandment to younger kids, like when I was a youth director, I'd be like, what does that mean? And I'd say, so if your parent tells you to clean your room and you roll your eyes at them, is that being, you know, have you broken this commandment? No. Yes, okay. Speaking to an older congregation, a little bit different aged crowd, how do I turn this around, you know, and make you uncomfortable with it? And this one made me uncomfortable when I read it, so I threw it in here. It's one thing to have a child. Being a parent and showing your children the same sacrificial love that God shows us takes humility. This commandment comes with a responsibility. Parents, doesn't this commandment assume that we are to be worthy of honor? Calvin and Luther agreed on this commandment. Fellow men are to be loved. Father and mother are to be honored, feared, and revered. It's relationships, right? And it goes two ways. I know as a parent, I've had my failures over the years. I've done things and thought, I hated it when my dad did that, you know? And I think that's common in all relationships. So it's important to recognize and to remember this isn't just an upward conversation of honor your father and mother, but also as parents, as grandparents, we should live our lives in ways that ought to be honored and feared as well. Number 5, this one gets me every time, thou shalt not kill. Darn it. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so we do our neighbor no bodily harm, nor cause him any suffering, but help and befriend him in every need. So ultimately, if your neighbor asks you for a cup of sugar and you say, no, I don't want to go to the grocery store by next Tuesday because I'm planning on using my last cup of sugar, whatever the argument is, no matter how small it is, if you're not helping your neighbor and befriending them in every need, you're ultimately in your heart committing murder. And I should point out in Hebrew thought, unauthorized taking of human life is what it means to murder or to kill in this instance. This commandment is not an argument for passivism. It's not saying that we shouldn't go to war. You look at how many wars were fought in the Old Testament in the name of God, and it was not sin for God's people to make conquest of the promised land under God's direction, because the people that they were going in there, they were worshiping false gods. And so should understand that. It's not about not going to war. can't use that as a proof text. It should echo and resound sanctity for human life in all stages, whether it be murder, spur of the moment, or spontaneous, or premeditated. It doesn't matter. That's outside the realm. You can't do it according to this commandment. Abortion, suicide, assisted suicide. Psalm 139, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You are a child of God. You are a creature of God. And as a child of God that God has created, that's why I said creature, I meant a created being, you ought to look to your neighbor and your friends, whether you like them or you hate them, whether they're I hate saying the word Karen, but you know what I mean when I say the Karen of the HOA comes and knocks on your door and says, I'm going to fine you for having your grass too long. What does that instill in your heart other than the desire to kill somebody, right? I mean, if we're being honest with each other, you guys are going to not like me by the time I'm done preaching these commandments. And I don't have an HOA, so just examples. See stuff on YouTube, you know. It's easy to fall short of this commandment, especially when you recognize Jesus' words, if you have hated someone in your heart, then you have broken this commandment. Number six, thou shalt not commit adultery. What does this mean, Luther asks. We should fear and love God so that we lead a chaste and pure life in word and deed, and that husband and wife love and honor each other. Bible study got off topic a little bit this morning, and we were talking about Levitical laws at some point, and all of the, in Leviticus it says, you shall not sleep with this person, you shall not sleep with that person, and it goes into all these great descriptions of your husband's sister, and your goes on and on and on. And, you know, it's not that hard. If you're not married, you don't have sex. You take all of those laws about adultery, and it's that simple. And today's world, we have the LGBTQIA+, all of that, and the church seems to be focusing on that because we've become so numb to premarital sex or affairs that's not as big an issue anymore for us. And it is, and it should be, and we should recognize that probably as the start of all this other. And what happens if you don't treat the disease and you only treat symptoms? The symptoms get worse and they change, right? And so when it comes to thou shalt not commit adultery, we are to recognize that God desires us to be his holy people, to be set apart. I have a couple verses in here I wanted to read. Proverbs 6:32 says, but a man who commits adultery lacks judgment. Whoever does so destroys himself. You're tearing down your own heart in the midst of it. And then Hebrews 13:4, marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed be kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and the sexually immoral. All. Not those who aren't married yet, but all. Okay, I had more on that, but I want to keep it simple. Number seven, thou shalt not steal. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so we do not rob our neighbor of his money or property, nor bring them into our possession by unfair dealing or fraud, but help him to improve and protect his property and living. Exodus 22:1, it says, if a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it, he must pay back 5 head of cattle or for the ox and 4 sheep for the sheep. So it was a 4 times, you know, 4 to 5 times, what do you call that, retribution to get back for one thing being stolen. Jesus speaks of this, Matthew 5:38-44, you have heard what it is said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, right? We're going from the bony finger of the law. You stole, so now we're going to make you give back 4 times what you stole. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person, for if someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn him also the other. And if someone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. If someone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard what it is said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Not very many governments or religions in the world will tell you to love your enemies. But Christ, again, shows us grace in this commandment. While not only are we called to love our enemies, but we ought to expect all of our Christian brothers and sisters in Christ to love our enemies as well. There's a question on this commandment. Who does this belong to? Anybody want to guess? Think me, right? If you think that this belongs to me, it becomes very easy to break this commandment and to go steal something. This, everything in this room, everywhere you look, every car in the parking lot, belongs to God. We are but stewards of these items. When you steal from your friend or your enemy, you steal from God and you break this commandment. Don't steal. Another one comes back to youth ministry days, I'd be like, have you ever stolen anything? And the kids would be like, no, I've never stolen. I'm like, really? Like, you showed up for school and you forgot your pencil and your neighbor's locker was unlocked. You didn't just grab a pencil out of there. But I was only borrowing it. Oh, so you asked him if you could borrow it? Well, no. So you gave it back? Well, no. We've all stolen, right? And when we steal from God. Last page. This was my longest typed out, and anyway, good stuff, so bear with me. Number 8, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so we do not deceitfully lie about, betray, backbite, or slander our neighbor, but defend him, speak well of him, and put the most charitable construction on all that he does. You know, gossip, talking about stuff out of turn. John chapter 8, verse 43 says, why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil. You want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar, the father of lies. If we put all of our embellishing stories, you know, the fish story where that fish turned into that fish. Little lies beget bigger lies, beget more lies, and we become liars, and then people can't see truth in us. And God wants to see him in us, so we are called as Christians to tell the truth. Another point about this commandment is that people remember lies. I remember very clearly the first time an adult outright flat lied to me. I think I was in the second grade. I know the person's name. I know when it happened. And I know other adults in the community that were like good friends with this person. And I have no respect for them. I don't know. I suppose I need to work on my forgiveness, right? But as a second grader, being lied to by an adult was a little bit outrageous, you know. And it affects you and you remember it. So as Christians, we ought to let our yes be yes and our no be no, and we ought to not be lying, because, again, it's not only this commandment, it's taking the Lord's name in vain, it's making up our own story, which is ultimately idolatry, making us God over whatever truth there was. We're changing that. It's a bad road to go down. Number 9, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. What does this mean? We should fear and love God, so we do not seek by craftiness to gain possession of our neighbor's inheritance or home, nor obtain them under pretense of a legal right, but assist and serve him in keeping the same. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his cattle, nor anything that belongs to his neighbor. What does this mean? We should fear and love God, so we do not estrange or entice away our neighbor's wife, servants, or cattle, but seek to have them remain and fulfill their duty to him. I really like Luther's point here in the ninth one, that we're not supposed to obtain things under pretense of a legal right. And there's a verse that keeps coming to my mind, and I can't remember the address. It's in Corinthians somewhere, and it says, all things are permissible for me, but not all things are beneficial for me. And a lot of times I think of that in accordance with, like, substances, like, you know, marijuana, it's legal, so let's go do it. And I say, but is it something that God wants me to use? And anyway, go down that road, whatever you will. But sometimes we might come across legal ways to make transactions that we know are going to hurt somebody. And Luther says, just because it's legal, just because you have a pretense or a legal right, if you're coveting, if you're trying to take something away from your neighbor that your neighbor doesn't want taken away from them, then you're falling into this desire to take from someone else. And really, again, if you remember the question, who does this belong to? And you think of your neighbor's house, which would include not just the home or the land, but also the inheritance that went along with it. And then everything in that house and home, all of it, it's God's. And we ought to deal with things like that as they belong to God. The root of coveting, when what God has given us is not good enough. I always give an illustration of a children's message that I don't ever want to give because it would cost money, but you take a $1 bill and you put it in a basket, and you take a $10 bill and you put it in a basket, and you take a $100 bill and you put it in another basket, and you get all the kids down here, and you kids are like, oh yeah, I like this idea, and you give the first kid the basket with $1 in it, and they look at that and they go, oh, this is mine, this is great, oh, $1, wonderful. And then you give the second kid the basket with the $10 bill in it, and they pull it out, oh, this is great, I got $10, this is wonderful. What happens to the first kid when that happens? Oh, okay, man, you didn't get you $10, I only got one. And then the third kid gets their basket with $100, oh, this is the best day of my life, I got $100. And then all of a sudden now the kid with the $10 and the kid with the $1 looking at the other two, that's not fair, right? And it sounds like a silly, funny little story, but ask yourself if you can't apply that happening to you somewhere along the line in your life where you looked at your neighbors and saw what they did and thought, I deserve that, because you saw somebody else got it. All of these commandments can be put back into my track high jump illustration. The bar for the commandments is set so high, we as God's people cannot jump over it. But God knew that, and he sent his son to die for our sins because he could jump over that bar. The price to get your forgiveness was Christ dying on the cross for your sins. That cleared the bar, and therefore, because Christ didn't deserve that punishment of dying on the cross for your sins, you receive the benefit. You receive the benefit. For the Christian, following the Ten Commandments is a good thing. It is how to live a blessed life, how to live a life that points to Christ in every part of our life. Can we do it perfectly? I sure can't, okay? If you think you can, I think you're defining the commandments differently than history, than the Bible does, okay? So if I make the commandments sound impossible, they are, and that's on the Old Testament side of the cross. They're on the New Testament side of the cross. They're for building up the believer. And I have one last quote from Luther that I cannot leave out of this message. Luther says, if you are a preacher of grace, then preach a true and not a fictitious grace. If grace is true, you must bear a true and not a fictitious sin. God does not save people who are only fictitious sinners. This is the famous quote, right? Probably one of Luther's most quoted things. He says, be a sinner and sin boldly. Right? I've seen Lutheran, I think it was called Old Lutheran, it's a Missouri Synod website, or it was not, It's not a Missouri-centered website. It was some Missouri-centered pastors, I believe, that put it together is what the information I was told. But they sell hats, and the hat says, like, sin boldly on it, you know, just that. And the idea is, you know, you could go to the bar and drink with your hat that said sin boldly, and oftentimes people just cut this quote off there. Be a sinner and sin boldly. But Luther continues. He says, but believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly, for he is victorious over sin, death, and the world. As long as we are here in this world, we have to sin. This life is not the dwelling place of righteousness, but as Peter says, we look for a new heaven and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. It is enough that by the riches of God's glory, we have come to know the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. No sin will separate us from the Lamb, even though we commit fornication and murder 1,000 times a day. Do you think that the purchase price that was paid for the redemption of your sins by so great a Lamb is too small? Pray boldly. You too are a mighty sinner. Okay? So, mighty sinners, let me close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks. We thank you for giving us your law, and we thank you that your law not only makes us realize we need you and we need your salvation, but that it also is a guide for us. And by living our lives according to your law, we can even bring more people to know you in a personal way. And we thank you for the gift of these words. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let us rise and sing together hymn number 447, He Leadeth Me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Let us sing together hymn number 506, Living for Jesus. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.